I'd like to buy the world a home and furnish it with love. Grow apple trees and honey bees and snow white turtle doves. I'd like to teach the world to sing. Sing with me.
Perfect harmony.
Perfect harmony.
I'd like to buy the world a home
and keep it company.
John Stith Pemberton was born on July 8, 1831, in Knoxville, Georgia. At the age of 17, Pemberton attended Southern Botanical Medical College of Georgia. After graduating in 1850, Pemberton moved to Philadelphia for a year of schooling and got licensed as a pharmacist. Finally, Pemberton moved to Oglethorpe, Georgia, where he began his true career as a druggist. Here, Pemberton met Anna Lewis, whom he married in 1853. Together, they had one son, Charles Ney Pemberton.
And in the basement of a house in Atlanta, Georgia, an unsuccessful pharmacist was brewing up something that started out as a soft drink, but ended up an icon of its own. His name was John Pemberton. Everybody in Atlanta knew him as Doc, and he'd spent most of his life looking for the product that was going to make him rich.
There's not a lot that is known about Pemberton and his life. He took some medical training early in his career. He had some training as a pharmacist. He served in the Civil War as an officer in the Confederate forces. And after the war, he settled in Columbus, Georgia, and began the practice of pharmacy, and also began the practice of trying to invent commercially successful products.
He introduced pills, hair dyes, medicines, and never managed to make a success of any of them. In 1870, he moved to Atlanta, a booming, brawling railroad town still rising from the ashes of Sherman's March. In those days, civic leaders were anxious to leave the wounds of the Civil War behind, make amends with the North, and joined the 19th century's industrial revolution. They called it the New South, and Atlanta would lead the way. The city's cash crop was cash, and Doc Pemberton was hoping to harvest his share. Unfortunately, Atlanta wasn't any kinder to the pharmacist than Columbus had been. He still couldn't come up with a real moneymaker.
After many attempts at creating a successful medicine, John Pemberton created French wine cola. The cola was used as a remedy for nervous disorders and morphine addiction. But French wine cola was not just used as a remedy, it was used as a beverage for everyone to enjoy.
But by the spring of 1886, Pemberton had yet another bright idea, and more importantly, a new business partner. A Yankee.
I love the idea that Coke is founded by this odd couple, because you have this handsome chemist, a Civil War hero, Doc Pemberton from Columbus, Georgia, But we wouldn't know what we were talking about today if it hadn't been for this diminutive Yankee veteran of the Union Army who just wandered into town with a small printing press and tried to gain a career in advertising, and that's Frank Robinson.
Robinson's advertising know-how made him a natural partner for Pemberton, who was always better at creating products than he was at selling them. Together, they decided to focus on that new idea Pemberton had been tinkering with, a beverage.
Together with his advertising partner, Frank Robinson, Pemberton opened up a local soda fountain for everyone to enjoy the beverage. The soda fountain became a hit sensation. It became a place of entertainment and a place where women could enjoy freedom of censorship.
Just a small town girl, living in a lonely world. He took the midnight train going anywhere.
The public demand for soda water led to many different experiments through the years to achieve a taste that was unique in the carbonated drink. Blending, mixing, many different products of nature to capture just the right taste. By the time bicycles were built for two, the corner drugstore was the counterpart of the inns and the watering places of colonial days. The soda fountain was fast becoming a traditional aspect of American life, helping to make the 90s gay. Here were the life, excitement, everyday sociability for all desiring refreshment. Syrup. Finely chipped ice. Sparkling carbonated water. People talked about the new drink, tried it, and way back then, learned just how delicious and refreshing the pause that refreshes was. So good to taste in such good taste. The new drink became America's favorite and grew up with the soda fountain.
Soda fountain wasn't just a place to go and refresh yourself because you were thirsty. It was a place to sit down with your friends, to have conversations, to talk about the politics, the culture. And so it was a place where people naturally gathered.
They're important as new kinds of meeting places in a changing downtown atmosphere that includes both men and women, for one thing. This is a place where ladies can go without fear of censorship. They can go to drugstores and sit at a soda fountain and partake in some ice cream confection.
Soda fountains offered a dizzying array of flavors, variations on well-known tastes like strawberry, lemon, or chocolate. All were prepared by mixing a thick syrup with carbonated water and adding ice. Pemberton hoped to come up with something that would stand apart from the crowd. For months, he worked in the basement of the Atlanta house that served as his home and laboratory. He added flavorings to boiling water to make a syrup. And every so often, he'd dispatch a sample to the soda fountain at Jacob's Pharmacy to see what people thought.
It's very hard to go back to May of 1886 and try and figure out what was in the mind of a man like John Pemberton. My guess is that in his mind, he was just trying to find a magical formula that was going to sell. And so you took it one drink at a time. You took it one container of syrup at a time. People said they liked it. Let's try another one.
On May 8, 1886, he decided that he finally had it right. It was a brand new flavor, and more than a century later, it's hard to understand the impact it must have had on the first people who drank it. It's not as if Pemberton had created a new kind of cola. There were no colas, period.
The cola flavor is a very distinct kind of flavor. And it's something that, you know, flavor chemists tell us is something that you forget very quickly. So that you can have a cola flavored drink and maybe half an hour later you're ready to have another cola flavored drink.
Unfortunately, on August 16, 1888, Pemberton died of stomach ailments and never lived to see the true success of his product.
Stomach ailments that had plagued him since the Civil War flared up again. Pemberton took to his bed, and his company nearly went under. The true success of Coca-Cola would come too late for the man who created it. John Pemberton died in August 1888 at the age of 57, never having tasted the success he had sought all his life.
Pemberton was just one of these guys who was always trying to, you know, get the golden ring, and he just didn't make it. I mean, he had no history of success. And I think there's a good argument that might suggest that had John Pemberton remained the person behind the product, that the product would never have achieved the success that it has achieved.
Right before Pemberton's death, businessman Asa Griggs Candler bought the shares of Coca-Cola from Pemberton and other shareholders. Asa Griggs Candler is highly credited with the success of the company and became known as its co-founder.
In fact, the man who would rescue Doc Pemberton's invention probably couldn't have been any less reckless. Asa Griggs Candler once asked Doc Pemberton for a job and was turned down. Like Pemberton, he'd come to Atlanta to seek his fortune. He'd arrived in the city at age 21 with $1.75 in his pocket, looking for work in a drugstore. He couldn't get a job at Pemberton's, but he eventually recovered from that blow. Unlike Pemberton, he did make his fortune in Atlanta. By the late 1880s, his company was taking in as much as $100,000 a year. He was also a pillar of rectitude. No one could accuse Asa Candler of being a frivolous man, whether in his business dealings or his personal beliefs. For him, the two were intertwined, a common way of looking at the world for businessmen of the time. Sometime in 1888, Robinson came to Candler and asked the pharmacist if he wanted to invest in Coca-Cola. The answer was no. He wasn't interested in a new product, and besides, his drugstore didn't have a soda fountain where he could sell Coca-Cola anyway. Then, a historic event. Asa Candler tried Coca-Cola for the first time. It is probably safe to call that one glass the most important Coke ever served. Later, Candler would claim that that one drink made him a true believer in the possibilities of Coca-Cola.
Candler's genius, I think, lie in the fact that he did see the opportunities that were there in broadening the base of the beverage out of its Atlanta beginnings into becoming increasingly more of a national beverage.
By 1891, Candler was the sole owner of Coca-Cola. His total investment, about $2,300. Sales had already begun to take off in Atlanta. Now, Candler set about making Coca-Cola a household word.
What Candler possessed that Pemberton did not was a vision, and he also possessed a very strong marketing capability.
If Coca-Cola was going to expand beyond its regional roots, Candler would have to make people aware of this new beverage. He had to convince a skeptical public that it was special and make them care whether they got the real thing or not. But Candler had faith in Coca-Cola and believed that one glass would win over even the toughest customer. In the beginning, he turned to a trick Frank Robinson had been using, giving Coca-Cola away for free. He hired traveling salesmen to hand out tickets in cities and towns across the country, each one good for a free glass of Coca-Cola. In essence, Asa Candler wanted to buy the world a Coke.
And obviously the concept was, you'd try it once, you'd like it, the next time you came in, you'd pay for it. Very simple, elementary concept, but Coke was the first company to use that concept, and Candler was the one who recognized that in order to get business, you had to get folks to try the product first.
In 1895 alone, the company redeemed $7,700 worth of coupons, 154,000 glasses of Coke, and sales continued to climb.
During the Great Depression in 1941, Coca-Cola produced a film known as Always Tomorrow to encourage consumers to buy their products, advertising it would relieve them from the Depression.
Hiya, Sam.
Found a job yet?
Not yet.
Well, times is tough, all right.
Yeah, I'll say. Two bottles of Coca-Cola.
He'll pay for them.
None of that now. I'll match it.
Lady Luck. Larry's always talking about it. Well, in one respect, we were lucky in the way we rode out of the Depression. Our Lady Luck was Coca-Cola. A bottle of Coca-Cola is just a little thing. It costs just a little, yet it's truly one of the pleasant things of life. People enjoy stopping at the bright red coolers for an ice-cold bottle of Coca-Cola. Time out for refreshment, enjoyment, sociability. The pause that refreshes, we say. And the price, 5 cents, puts it within the reach of everybody. An awful lot of nickels rolled in during those Depression years. Maybe it's because people had more nickels to spend those years than anything else.
James Quincy is the president of Coca-Cola Europe. What good does Coca-Cola do you physically?
I think Coca-Cola, as the introduction said, does have some sugar in it. It is energy. Is it an absolute necessity? No, it's not. Millions of people enjoy it as part of their diet across the UK.
Does have some sugar in it, you say?
It does.
Why don't you say specifically how much sugar there is in this can, for example?
I think if you find,
on the side, you see 13, you have a percentage on there, don't you?
Yes, right here on the front, it quite clearly calls out the amount of sugar in this can of Coke.
And what 35 does it say? 35
grams, which is 6 teaspoons of sugar, which is, you know, about the same amount of calories as a cappuccino or half a croissant. So there is calories. What we're doing is to say, look, the information is here. We want to actually promote and make sure
people do know. Do you imagine people know if they go to the cinema and they get, this is a small one and there are big ones here too. You go to the cinema and you get a jug of Coke like this. Do you think people have any idea how much sugar's in it?
And maybe they don't. And I think one of the things we need to do...
Do you know what it is? Look at this. 23 sachets of sugar in that single container, the equivalent thereof. Now, that is a staggering amount of sugar, isn't it?
That is why we're very focused, as one of the things we're doing, on getting the information out there. We're not trying to hide the information behind what's in a Coca-Cola
Classic. But
you are
trying to hide it.
But there's zero sugar in a Coke Zero.
Although debates still continue on the nutritious value of Coke, one thing that has remained the same for over a century is the secret recipe of the beverage. Even though people have claimed to have had the secret formula, the formula has yet to have been properly emulated. Recently, Coca-Cola CEO Muhtar Kent placed the secret recipe in a vault at the Coca-Cola Museum.
Coke says the product reaches 99% of mankind. Despite its worldwide presence, the company itself makes primarily one thing: the highly condensed beginnings of the drink known as beverage concentrate. But Coke won't say exactly where they make the concentrate, nor will they allow the modern-day filming of its manufacturing processes.
The formula for Coca-Cola may be the most closely guarded secret in the history of American commerce.
The ingredients are listed, but there's one that's purposely vague: natural flavors.
Those are things which have come from nature, from many different sources of plants, or vegetables, or things like that. That's actually the most closely guarded trade secret in the world, so we don't actually say what they are.
There's one thing that probably won't change.
For 125 years, the formula for Coca-Cola has been the world's most closely guarded commercial secret. Our intention is to make it that way for another 125 years.
Oh, beautiful for spacious skies,
por tus olas de granos d'ámbar,
yo.
Myself a real good time. I feel alive.